Good morning, Jamie Love. Today is Wednesday, March 27th, 2024. We're here in room W1 of the World Health Organization headquarters at INB9, which is short for International Negotiating Body, Intergovernmental Negotiating Body to negotiate the pandemic treaty. Can you tell me, why are you here?
Well, I think this is an important negotiation, potentially important. I mean, if it succeeds, it's important even if it fails. I mean, there's a lot riding on the outcome of this negotiation, both in terms of the substance of what they might agree upon and what it says about the future or the near future of countries to come to any kind of an agreement on something really important for global health in a multilateral setting. And I think if you're, people are engaging in different ways in this on this negotiation. I know a lot of people are advising countries that are not in the room. And you know, they do it over email, they do it through WhatsApp and things like that. But the advantage of actually being in the room is you really have an opportunity to meet delegates, talk to other NGOs, to kind of get a feel for what's going on in the negotiation. And if people have the opportunity to be here, it really can make a big difference, and it's a privilege, I think, for KEI to be able to have a couple of people on the ground here.
Yeah, Jamie, because if I recall, INB7, which had two sessions in November and December of 2023, that was the first time, basically, the WHO allowed relevant stakeholders and NSAs and official relations like ours to physically enter the building. Prior to that, we could only participate remotely. And I guess my question to you is, would you say being physically present, since November makes a difference for?
Yeah, well, it makes
groups.
A big difference. I mean, one of the frustrations has been the WHO has been so secretive about this negotiation. I mean, a lot of people really are paranoid about the WHO. You have a million conspiracy theories, and all the secrecy about this negotiation is really unhelpful in building trust in this institution or multilateral institutions in general. Now, in contrast, the WHO is probably the hardest organization to get credentialed as an NGO that we work in. The World Intellectual Property Organization and the World Trade Organization is much easier to become accredited than it is at the WHO. I think people had to be kind of recommended by countries actually to get accreditation to.
That's what I understand for, if an organization was not in official relations, there was what they created an Annex E of relevant stakeholders and. Exactly. A country had to nominate a group or a person sometimes.
Yeah, so the accreditation is difficult, and then they wouldn't even let people in the building. Now, in contrast, the World Intellectual Property Organization, it's really pretty easy to get accredited to participate in the meetings, and you can be in the room where the negotiations take place, and even the informals, they typically allow you to do. If you're on the ground, you're often allowed to listen in on them, and WIPO webcast the official sessions of the meeting, and they archive them on the internet, and none of that's taking place here at the World Health Organization. So, look at the World Health Organization passed a resolution on transparency in 2019. Every member of the WHO basically kind of ignored it during the pandemic. One of the biggest complaints people had during the pandemic is people didn't know what was going on and there was way too much secrecy about everything. Here, we'd asked for a chapter on transparency in the pandemic treaty. We didn't get a chapter, but there are quite a few references to transparency in text, but the negotiations on transparency and every other matter are secret here. Now they have published, the publishing of the text has been better than the WTO. They have published a few versions of the text. They had a version that they published on March 7th, for example. But the March 7th version of the text that they negotiated it turned out to be like not remotely close to what's going on in the room here today.
And on that point, Jamie, thanks for mentioning that. Roughly how many pages was that March text that is public? Around 30 pages?
I haven't paid that much attention to the pages, but I think it's sort of gone from, you know, kind of low 30s to over 100. So, but what's important, I think, is the number of brackets that are in the text. And then there's two issues, like what are the areas of controversy?
Jamie, sorry to interrupt. With respect to brackets, I think you and I would understand what that means.
A lot of people understand what brackets are. Yeah. But I mean, brackets are areas where there's more than one opinion about what the text should say. That's what they negotiate at these agreements. And you know, when you look at the March 7 version of the text coming into the meeting, you know, I was asked, like, you know, do you think they can pull it off by May? And I thought, well, it's such a clean looking text. And, you know, you didn't know what was happening in all these secret negotiations and all these informals and stuff. So our initial impression was, yeah, we were pretty optimistic about something coming out the other end. And then you get here, and so far, like, the U.S. has already put in about 530 brackets into the text, just one country. And there's somewhere between 4,000 and 5,000 brackets in the text right now, that as of last night. And it's just insane. So, but there's two issues, kind of like, what are the areas of disagreement? The WHO could publish the text with the brackets so you could figure out what's actually being negotiated, but even more informative and make things more accountable is if they publish the country positions on each bracket, which are, I mean, people are getting them because the delegates are leaking them to the press. And so, you know, Politico has been publishing, you know, several versions, so we have that data now. But it's crazy. I mean, you have an institution that's criticized for secrecy, all kinds of conspiracy theories, and they're forcing the public to get leaked versions of the text from a paywalled publication, Politico. It's not a good look. And the other thing that would make it more transparent is if they actually webcast the debates about the text, which they do at WIPO. I mean, the World Intellectual Property Organization already is planning to do two diplomatic conferences this year on treaties, and all of those negotiations take place in a very transparent way. And we'll find out if they're going to do a third diplomatic conference in a few weeks, right? But the World Intellectual Property Organization has been able to negotiate binding legal instruments on intellectual property in areas that are controversial, and they've been able to do it in a very transparent manner. And here we are at the World Health Organization, run by, you know, like, health ministers are like a big part of the delegations, and, you know, it's just really annoying secrecy. So that's one of the reasons why being on the ground is important, because, you know, it's important, you know, to kind of figure out what's going on. You can talk to delegates and they'll tell you what the U.S. is doing, what the EU is doing, what the Africa group is doing, from just talking to people, you know, in the cafeteria and things. But it doesn't have to be this secret. But the reason why the negotiations are going badly is because the countries are really divided on matters of substance.
And can I ask you, so two follow-up questions on what you just mentioned, Jamie. What are some of the fields or articles that you are paying close attention to? And then secondly, what are some of the divisive issues that you've observed on the ground here in Geneva?
Well, I mean, there's the issues that we're kind of asking people to do things on the text that we think might be helpful, a kind of a small number of issues we try and weigh in on, but we're interested in the whole thing. I mean, the language in the preamble is important. The language on almost every article is important. I think the regulatory provisions are not an area that we're spending a lot of time on, but I certainly think there are several articles that people people tend to, you know, there's over 30 articles in the text, and people tend to maybe focus on a couple that they're interested in, but it doesn't mean the other ones aren't really consequential and potentially beneficial. There's two things that I think kind of dividing people. One are kind of the intellectual property technology transfer issues, where you see the European Union, the United States, Canada, Japan, the UK, and Switzerland kind of lining up with industry, with the pharma industry, you know, against countries, particularly developing countries who want to see more technology transfer and more flexibility on intellectual property rules. And the other one is on funding. And I hadn't really followed the funding issues, but I understand that that'll be one of the more difficult things, challenging things to deal with in this negotiation. Now, the benefit sharing chapter, when everyone talks about it as being kind of one of the critical things, obviously is dividing people, primarily around the tracking of the digital information about sequences. And it's been our position that there should be a lot of access to knowledge in terms of the digital information about pathogens and also the samples. We also strongly support all the equity demands. A lot of the high income countries are blocking the equity things outside of the pathogen access and benefit sharing part of the agreement. So they're blocking it in the chapters on research and development, the supply chain, technology transfer. They're blocking the equity provisions there. They're resisting any kind of effort to set up a funding, equity funding mechanisms. So then everything kind of gets dumped onto the PABs, is where, you know, not everything, but in a way, I put there's a disconnect. Like, you've got the EU and the United States and all the sort of fellow travelers of the pharma supporting countries saying they want to have more liberal access to the pathogen information, but they're not very flexible on the other ways you get equity in the agreement. So you end up sort of tying the access to the pathogen information to the equity provisions in the negotiation. Doesn't have to be that way, but the reason it is that way is because it's being blocked in other parts of the agreement, in our opinion. Now, I don't know if there's a solution to that at this particular meeting. I think countries are pretty dug in on their positions.
And Jamie, this was supposed to be the last marathon, INB9. And we're hearing reports of
it won't be the last, but well, it could be the last in the sense that there are some countries that just want to say that this is a failed negotiation. And, we were hearing yesterday that the European Union was sort of saying that if they can't get it done by May, they just, you know, this process will end as we know it. You don't know if that's a negotiating position, if it's tactical, or if it's how they, you know, if it's authentic. But it's not obvious that that if they can't get it done by May, if there will be anything after May. It could be that they extend it a year or two. It could be that they just declare, you know, walk away from it. I can't tell you myself. I don't know which of those things will happen, but. It's clearly, you know, it doesn't take a genius to figure out that the negotiators are pretty far apart on every single chapter in the text right now.
Thank you, Jamie. I have two last questions. The first is, was there anything that surprised you about this particular negotiation, INB9, last week or this week?
Yeah, well, I looked at the March 7 text and I thought, wow, it looks like things are really moving along, you know. And I live in the United States, and I had kind of under the impression coming in here that the U.S. was going to show more flexibility. We'd heard they're going to show more flexibility on the R&D chapter, on the things. We've had good conversations with them on the technology transfer chapter. And you know, I kind of thought the U.S. was going to, you know, we had a good conversation with USTR. So we thought we were kind of optimistic coming in. We saw what we looked like kind of a clean text, and I thought the U.S. was going to be more constructive. But I can say from being here that apparently the United States has really taken a lot of the decisions are made in Washington, D.C. They're not made by the negotiators here. A lot of the instructions, which are really hardline pro-farmer things, are coming out of the National Security Council and the Department of Commerce. Things at a very high level. This is very much a White House-driven, cabinet-driven thing, and it's as if the U.S. is much closer to pharma than I thought coming into the meeting. So it's a disappointment to me. I thought under Biden you would have seen more flexibility and more willingness to work on the equity agenda, but I'm definitely not seeing it this week.
And my final question, Jamie, is this: on a scale of 1 to 10, or 10 being yes, like there will be an agreement concluded in by the WHA in 2024, i.e., in 2 months, or 1 meaning no agreement, what are you feeling now?
1/10 of 1.
Okay. Thank you for your time, Jamie.